What does it mean for the child of God to be still? Stillness is not simply not moving, but it is a command to relax. This truth can be seen in the first and last verse of this psalm. Because the psalmist states in verse 1, God is our refuge and strength. And ends the psalm with a reassurance, the God of Jacob is our refuge. This is important for the child of God because Psalm number 46 lists some terrible and frightening experiences, but from the first verse to the conclusion of the psalm, it does not matter what is going on around us. God is our refuge, and because God is our refuge, I can be still. Now, the psalmist said, though the earth be removed, and though the mountain be carried into the sea, and although the waters roar and the mountains shake, I got a refuge in God. The use of the word refuge in the text is descriptive. It means that God is our hiding place. He is a place of rest away from the troubles of this world. In him, it suggests that we can relax. In him, it suggests that we are covered. And in him, it says that we have a present help in God. David, back over in Psalm number 27, he speaks of God's help. He first he describes God saying, the Lord is my light and my salvation. And he says, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? And then David, he goes on to explain some circumstances of life. He had some enemies, some wicked people that were seeking to do him harm. But he said, every time they came up on me, God tripped them. He suggests, he's letting us know that God is a present help in the time of trouble. He's letting us know that it does not matter how many enemies I got coming up on me, because as long as the Lord is on my side, he's going to fight my battle.
Well,
Because you are a child of God, God will fight your battles. He said he will prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies. Which lets us know that is that letting us know that we don't have to fight. We don't have to fight our enemy. We can just put our hands in our pockets. Matter of fact, sit down at your dinner table and put on your dinner napkins. Because he said he will prepare a table in the presence of your enemy. All around David, he had people that were desirous to do him harm. But God was fighting for him. And it doesn't matter who your enemies are, they can't do battle with God. I was trying to get to verse number 5 in Psalm 27. He said, because David said, in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. Again is the descriptive nature of God. He is a light, he is a pavilion, and in Psalm number 46, God is a refuge. And what we need to see in this life is whatever I need God to be at that time, God will be.
Amen.
He will be exactly what you need. The message of being still. It takes shape over in Mark. In Mark chapter four, it takes shape. It comes to life in chapter four when the disciples, along with Jesus, are sailing across the Sea of Galilee. The story is interesting because it was Jesus who said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Jesus said, "Let us pass over." And if Jesus is the one saying, "Let us pass over," you don't have to worry about going under.
Amen.
If Jesus says you're going to make it even in the midst of trouble, all that matters is what Jesus said.
Amen.
Matter of fact, if we think about it, there will be some circumstances in our life that make us forget about what Jesus said. We'll stop looking at his word, and we'll stop looking back on the prayer or the word that he gave us, because things can get so bad in our life that we stop believing what Jesus said. Because if you think about it, it's interesting. While they're on their way across the sea, here comes a storm. And Jesus was tired from the day's events. Jesus got a pillow and he went to sleep. And in the back of the ship, there was a storm, and the boat is being tossed to and fro by the wind and the waves. And this is the exact time that Jesus decided to take a nap. At the height of their fear and their worry, they turned around to awake Jesus, and all Jesus said was, "Peace, be still." And I began to wonder as I read that text. I wondered, could Jesus have been talking to the disciples as well? Because in his presence there is peace. All the worries and anxieties are to cease in Jesus' presence. And while this is true, the disciples could not be still even in the presence of Jesus. Which suggests, my brothers and sisters, as we think about it, when we are in the presence of Jesus, and how come, why is it we can't be still? Because we think that this problem is bigger than Jesus.
Well, we can't
be still. It suggests that we don't trust him enough. Jesus said, "Peace, be still," and telling them that you ought to have peace in my presence.
Yes.
They worried about a storm. They couldn't be still because their focus was in the wrong place. And far too often, we are robbed of peace because we refuse to rest in Jesus. We're looking to rest in something or someone else. Refusing to rest in Jesus. He lets us know that in the midst of the storm, he went to sleep. But those that were with him, they were panicking and losing their minds because they had lost focus of Jesus. And whenever you lose focus of Jesus, you're going to start panicking.
Yeah.
About these problems. Jesus says peace first. He says peace first, and then he says be still, because Jesus was resting peacefully because he knows who he is. He said peace not only to the wind and the wave, but to the disciples as well. They should have known if Jesus is not panicking, they should just matter. They suggest be still.
Yes.
Because when you know who he is and you know whose you are, it doesn't matter how the storm is raging, you can be still. The psalmist in this one, he said, be still and know that I am God. This is beyond intellectual knowledge. Because we can know someone but not know them intimately.
Right.
The psalmist, he's speaking of experience. He's letting us know that he knows him because of the things he's already done in his life.
Hallelujah, yes, sir.
I'm fully aware of my problems. I know what the doctor said. And I know I got more bills than I got money. And I know that on the job, they're talking about layoffs, but I also know, I am persuaded that all of my help comes from the Lord.
Yes, sir.
And since I know where my help comes from, I'm going to be still. I'm not going to panic. I'm not going to be all up in anxiety, anxious and worrying over these little small problems. Because we serve a big Jesus.
Amen.
We serve a big God. And if God is never worthy, I don't see why we will. It doesn't help us to stay up all night worrying about the stuff that we got to face. It doesn't help us to stay up all night over the problem that we face in this life. And if God never sleeps nor slumbers, then all I got to do is give that problem to Jesus in my prayer and go to sleep.
Praise God.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Because it does not help me to stay up. And if God is going to stay up, I might as well get some. He never sleeps nor does he slumber. God never gets tired.
Right.
And also God never gets tired of hearing from his children.
Yeah.
We can talk to him. We can talk to him day and night. We can talk to him while we are driving in our car. We can talk to him anytime, any place, and wherever we are, wherever we need the presence of Jesus, we can call on him.
Mm-hmm.
If you think about it, many of our problems are the result of how uptight we are.
Mm-hmm.
We are some wound up individuals, wound up over everything. We are so uptight that we can't hardly enjoy life anymore. A lot of our problems are the result of how busy we are. We can't be still because we think we are life's problem solvers. But the cares of this world, if you're not careful, will choke the life out of
sure
you.
Enough. Yeah. Sure enough.
It doesn't matter who you are, what you think of yourself, you can't solve all of life problems.
Amen.
If you think you can, you'll find yourself being choked to death by the cares of this world. Because if you think of it, you'll have all sorts of problems coming in your life. And if you're thinking that I gotta be the one to solve them, then you will never get anywhere in life. We bring destruction on ourselves trying to take the place of God. And all we are doing is damaging our spiritual root system. We thinking that I can take the place of God, that I can solve my problems, and not only my problems, but I can solve your problems too.
Hmm.
If you will just bring your problems to me as if I am God, if you will bring all of your problems to me, then I will solve your problem in the midst of solving my own problem. But what you are doing is you are damaging your spiritual root system.
Sure.
Because the further away you get from God, the further away you get from dependence on God, all you have is yourself.
Mm-hmm.
God, God in the Bible, he talks about, he says, cast all of your cares up on me. He said, casting them on him means, that means that I gotta let it go. Let it go and be still. And one of the hardest things for problem solvers is to be still. One of the hardest things for individuals who start thinking that they are the ones who gotta fix it is to be still and let God be God. Because I've gotten so used to being the one. I've gotten so used to being the one who is fixing things. What God says is, cast all of your cares upon me. Jesus also says, come unto me, all you who are labored and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Jesus attaches a promise in him. He said we can rest in him because he is our refuge. We have a place that we can go, that we can find rest. We can rest in him. He is our refuge. He lets us know that if you come to me, that's when you can rest.
Amen.
We are running ourselves to death.
Amen.
Running ourselves to death because we won't let Jesus take the wheel. We won't let Jesus run our lives because we are the ones still thinking that I can do it.
Right.
But as I say, life will show you. Matter of fact, God will show you that you can't do it without him.
Amen.
He's a refuge. Not only is there a command to relax, there is all relax and let go. We are also to recognize. He said, take the time to learn of God and recognize who he is. This speaks of recognizing his purpose for me, his perspective about me, and his presence with me. The recognition is important because all of the chaos that the psalmist explains or talks about or is experiencing in Psalm 46. God never asked him to take care of the problem. God never asked him to solve the world's problem.
Amen.
His purpose in all of this is found in verse number 10, where it says, be still and know that I am God. God was telling him, he wants him to see that. He wants him to see that your purpose is not to solve the world's problems. Because one of the things that we do see in this life is we see an epidemic of hunger. We see in this world an epidemic of drug abuse. And in this life, we see an epidemic of sin that's running rampant. But God did not call upon us. It is not our purpose to solve all the world's problems.
Mm-hmm.
That is a burden too heavy for any of us to carry. But God does tell us, he does show that we are to be salt and light wherever we go, so that the world may be able to see that there's a distinctive difference mm-hmm. about those who name the name of Jesus.
Amen.
When we sin our spiritual roots deep in the soil of a relationship with God, we can find strength to keep on going every day.
Yes.
Whenever you try to solve a God-sized problem, you become part of the problem.
Right.
All you got to do is relax and recognize that he is God.
Amen.
This wasn't really part of the sermon, but I need to slide it in because one of the things that's happening is we want to take the place of God. We want to be the ones that people heap praise on.
Mm-hmm.
We want to be the one that people give all these accolades to and people give all these attaboys to, because we want to be the one that taking the place of God. But let me go ahead and say this too, because your feet are too small for God's shoes. You look ridiculous walking around in shoes that are too big for your feet.
Amen.
And whenever you try to take the place of God, you have gotten outside of your ability. You can't do what God can do. You ain't never opened the Red Sea. You have never caused the walls of Jericho to fall. You ain't ever opened up any blinded eyes or unstopped the deaf ears, and you have never fed a multitude with 5 loaves and 2 barley and 2 fish. And since you can't do any of these things, there's no reason for you to start believing that you can take the place of God in somebody else's life. You can't do it. We are to recognize His presence. We are to recognize that He is a very present help in the time of trouble. God wants to do more than just help us through our day. He desires to be present in our day, and His presence is helping us. Knowing that Jesus is there will give us the help that we need to handle any problem. And deal with any circumstance and carry any burden. And lastly, we need to rely upon God. And this is one of the hardest areas that we have, other than being still, because we rely on ourselves most of the time. We rely on our income, our social status, our bank account, our looks, all of which can be taken away from us in the blink of an eye.
Sure enough, right?
Yes. We need to get out of God's way and let God do only what God can do.
Yeah.
He said, I am God. He said, look in verse number 10, He said, be still and know that I am God. And whenever you see the word I am, it tells us that God is able.
Amen.
We don't serve the I was or the I will be. We serve the I am, and the I am is able.
Amen.
Relying is allowing God to do what is necessary. When we think about it, at this I am statement, when Moses got ready to go in and face Pharaoh, he asked God, he said, who should I say sent me? And all God said was, you tell them that I am that I am. And He left it at that. And whatever you find yourself having to go in, you know that you can rely on the I am. Because it says that God is able. We rely on Him to do what is necessary. And what is necessary is not always going to be what we like. I know for myself that what I like ain't always good for me. It's good to me, but it's not good for me. And what God, if I rely on God to do what is necessary, God is not going to do just what I like.
Amen.
Because it may be necessary for God to remove some people from my life.
Hmm.
And it may be necessary for God to remove some things from my life.
Amen.
It's not always going to feel good. It's not always going to feel right, but whatever God is doing is necessary. In order for God to get us where we need to be, God has to do some hard things in our life. Sometimes he has to break us to make us.
Yes.
Sometimes he has to bend us and tear us down in order to build us up.
Amen.
And it may not feel good, but it's necessary. It may not. We may not like what he's doing, but we can trust that what he's doing is necessary and good for our lives. Because one of the things that we see over in the Gospels is that it was necessary for Jesus to die.
Yes.
It didn't look all that good, but what was happening on the cross was Jesus was dying for our sin.
Hallelujah.
And since he was dying for our sin, it let us know in the book that now we can live since Jesus died. It talks about over in the Gospels that when Jesus was dying on the cross, the veil of the temple was rent in twain. That means that now anybody has access to the Father through Jesus Christ. And only way to get to God was through Jesus. And there was no other way around it. It was necessary for Jesus to die. And what they did was, when they took him down from the cross, his word started to come back because he said, if you destroy this temple, I'll raise it again in 3 days.
Yes, sir.
And when they put Jesus in the grave, in the tomb, they put a stone in front of the door. But what happened on that third day when they went to check to see if he was still there, Jesus had already gotten up.
Hallelujah.
He lets us know that his word would not be returned unto him void. Whatever Jesus said, whatever the Bible says, will come to pass. Mm-hmm. There is nothing, there is no promise in the Bible that God hasn't fulfilled.
Amen.
He lets us know that God would not have allowed for his word to be written if his word couldn't be trusted. And so what we need to learn in this text is to relax, to recognize, and to rely on God. Mm. Because if you are relying on yourself, you are relying on the wrong person.
Right.
Amen.
And I've let myself down more times than I can count.
Me too.
And if you are relying on somebody else, you will still be let down.
Amen.
But if you rely on God, God will never let you down.
Yes.
Amen.
God bless you.